your hands together. We worship you. This is for you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Oh, Lord, you're good. We worship you. We give you praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. For who you are. For who you are. Lord, for who you are. For who you are. It's for who you are. Because you are good. Come on and give him praise. You can go to the next one. Hallelujah. We are friends of God no matter what. He wants to take care of us as we remain obedient to him. Hallelujah. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I that you are mindful of me? My God, you hear me when I call. Is it true that you're thinking of me? I'm so glad that you hear me. It's amazing. Friend of God, let me hear you say, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Say, I am a friend of God. 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 He calls me friend. Come on, say, who am I? Who am I that you are mindful of me? Thank you for hearing us, God, that you hear me. Every time I call, when I call. Come on, is it true? Yes, it's true. Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me, how you love me. No other word but amazing. It's amazing. Say, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. Say, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of in good times and bad times. I am a friend in happy and sad times. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Lift up that verse again. Who am I that you are mindful of me? We thank you, God, that you hear me. Every time I call, when I call. Is it true? I'm here to tell you, yes, it's true. Is it true that you are thinking of me? Thank you for loving us, God. How you love me. It's amazing. It's amazing. Oh, God. You are amazing. Oh, your love is amazing. Come on and thank him for being so amazing. Say, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. Say, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. Say, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. He calls me friend. He calls you friend. He calls you friend. He is God Almighty, Lord of glory. You have called me friend. You are God Almighty. thank you for taking care of us, Lord. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Say, I am a friend of, in good times and bad times, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Say, I am a friend of God. Everything's gonna be all right. I am a friend of God. He's got you. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. One more time, say, I am a friend of God. Lord, we love you. Oh, God, we can't thank you enough. You call us a friend. You call me friend. You call me friend. You call me friend. Come on and give him praise. Hallelujah, Lord, we praise you in this place. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. Hallelujah. We thank you that at all times you are awesome in our lives, Lord God. Whatever the mountain, God, you are the mountain mover. And we're here to give you praise, knowing that everything, Lord, is taken care of when you are the source and the head of it all. We love you, Lord. My God is awesome. He can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Hide me from the rain. My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken. Strength where I've been weakened. And ever he will reign. My God is awesome. My God is awesome. He can move the mountains. Keep me in the valley. Declare in this house, my God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken. He's my strength when I've been weakened. I declare forever he will reign. Lift your voice. Come on, this is easy. My God is awesome. Has he brought you out? Come on. Say awesome. Is he still bringing you through? Say awesome. Lord, I declare you. Today I am forgiven. His grace is why I'm living. Praise his holy name. Come on and declare with me. My God is awesome. No matter what you're facing, he is awesome. Good God Almighty, you're awesome. Lord, we love you. You're awesome. Repeat after me. He's mighty. He's mighty. He's mighty. Declare he's mighty. He's mighty. Oh, you're a mighty God. Mighty. You are awesome. God, you are awesome. Say he's holy. He's holy. Lord, he's holy. He's holy. God, you're holy. Holy. We declare you're holy. Holy. And you are awesome. Yes, you are awesome. Tell him he's great.
He's great.
He's great. God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Let your voice be the instruments. Say, our God is an awesome God. He reigns over us from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. There's nobody greater than our great God. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We worship you. May we hear what you would have to say, Lord God, in this house. I climbed up to the highest mountain. I looked all around. I couldn't find nobody. And I went deep into the deepest valley. All around down there, couldn't find nobody, no. I went across the deep blue sea. I couldn't find one to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy. You see, nobody's greater, nobody's greater than you. You see, I searched all over. I couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, and I still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody's greater, no. Nobody's greater than you. Let me testify. Nobody can heal like you can. Oh, most holy one, you are the great I am. Awesome in all your ways, and mighty is your hand. You are he who carried out redemption's plan. You are he who carried out redemption's plan. Say, searched all over. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Say, searched all over, searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low. I looked high and still couldn't find nobody. 'Cause nobody's greater. Oh, nobody's greater. Nobody's greater than you. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. No, nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Nobody greater. amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Nobody greater than you. You came from heaven to earth to show us the way. Nobody greater. From the earth to the cross, our debt to pay. Nobody greater than you. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Something about that name. Yes, there's something about that name. Nobody, there's no one that compares to you. Nobody greater. Come on and tell them, nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. Come on one more time, tell them, nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. No, nobody greater than you. Cause you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. Tell him you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. Come on and give him your worship. Come on and give him your praise. Hallelujah.
Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Come on, somebody, clap your hands. Hallelujah. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Father, Lord, we come into your house today, and we declare that there is no one greater. Lord, there is no greater God, because there is no other God like Jehovah. All other gods, they are false. They can't hear, they can't speak, they can't act, they can't perform, they can't do, they can't save, they can't deliver, they can't heal, they can't restore, they can't bring peace, they can't comfort. Lord, they can do none of these things because really they're just dumb idols. But you, oh God, are the one true living God. And you can, Lord, you can. Whatever we need, you said, I am. I am your Savior. I am your healer. I am your deliverer. I am your protector. I am your provider. I am your sustainer. I am, I am, I am. You said, I am. Hallelujah. And so we declare the greatness of our God this morning. We declare the wonder and the majesty and the power and the might of everything that you are and everything that you do. We bless you this morning in the sanctuary of the Most High God. And we shout out to you this morning that there is no God like Jehovah. We can climb to the highest mountain. We can look in the lowest valley, and we still can't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. No. You only. Give him a shout this morning. Hallelujah. Praise his wonderful name. In the name of Jesus, we bless you this morning and give you praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated this morning. How's everybody doing? It's good to see all of you. So, y'all doing all right? All right. Well, Pastor Rita is still in Oklahoma. She is having church this morning with the Wands in Chickasha, Pastor Joanne and Pastor Vaughn, and so I know they'll be having a good service and a good time this morning. Then she'll be returning sometime next week. Her and Hannah and Marissa will all be coming back. Y'all pray for traveling mercies for them as they'll be traveling in my car. Well, we'd pray for traveling mercies anyway for them, but yeah, that was funny. Are there any special announcements that I need to announce, or do we have a video or what? We got a video for the announcements. If you'll direct your attention to the screen, please.
Special announcements. Our next nursing home outreach ministry will be held on June 15th at 2 p.m. Join us for this awesome outreach opportunity. We'll be meeting at the church at 115 to caravan to Landmark Nursing Home. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble. James 1:27. Remember our special building fund. Please continue to give. Join us for prayer Saturdays at 6 p.m. For anyone interested that has the heart for children's ministry and is willing to sign up for training, please see Pastor Rita for details. Ignited Youth is hosting a raffle for a custom-made grill to raise money for summer youth camp. Tickets are a suggested donation of $5 each or 5 for 20. Congratulations to our 2013 graduates. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah 29:11. May God bless you all in your future.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, it's a good time. It's a real good time to receive the morning tithes and offerings. I want to do something this morning. While I was gone to Oklahoma, Miss BJ preached for me on Wednesday night. And she did a great job. All right, praise the Lord. That's awesome. Miss BJ depends 100% on the money that is given to her ministry through her ministry as she goes in ministry. She doesn't have any other means of income. She has no other outside job. She's 100% dependent upon what the people of God do for her. And she hasn't asked me for a nickel. She didn't even mention the offering. This was my idea because I know I've been on the road before and I have been dependent solely upon people's giving as I would go and preach. And so, you know, we've got people that help in so many areas. Tabitha's been coming for months now and helping us. And aren't we glad that Tabitha comes to help us? Amen. Hallelujah. And Tabitha, she works an outside job, so she's not 100% dependent. She's as much worthy of her hire as would BJ, but however, she does have other sources of income. And I'm going to do something soon for Tabitha as well from the church. But because this is how BJ supports her family and pays her bills, I want us to receive an offering for her this morning when we receive the tithes and offerings. Put your regular tithes and offerings in the plates. Put your offerings for BJ in the box. I'll give you a moment. If you want to write a check for BJ, you can write it to the House of Hope, and we'll write her one check after service today and give her everything that comes in. I'll give you just a minute to do that. Hallelujah. He's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. Hallelujah. He's everything that my soul ever longed for. He's everything He's promised, and He's so much more. More than amazing, more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. He's more than wonderful. That's what Jesus means to me. Oh, hallelujah. He's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. Hallelujah, Jesus. He's everything that my soul ever longed for. He's everything He's promised, and He's so much more. More than amazing, more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. He's more than wonderful. That's what Jesus means to me. Father, we thank You this morning for Your goodness and for Your mercies. We thank You, Lord, for all of the things, God, that You've done for us. Lord, You saved us, and that was really enough. You've given us eternal life through salvation that's in Jesus Christ our Lord. And what more could we ask for than to be forgiven of all our sins? What more could we ask for than the hope of eternal life with Jesus Christ? What more could we ask for than the reality of escaping this horrible place called hell and entering in into the wonders of God's heaven? Lord, nothing could be greater than that, and there's nothing that we could be more thankful for than that right there. But God, you've gone and you've healed us, you've delivered us, and you've blessed us, and you've caused us to prosper and caused us to be successful, Lord. And you've taken care of our children, and you've handled things that were outside of our scope of abilities to be able to do or to perform. And God, we can look back and see the handprint of God upon our lives and everything that you've done, Lord, how you kept us even from being involved in that accident, Lord, that surely we would have been in the middle of had we have left the house 5 minutes sooner. But Lord, you orchestrated things and caused us to miss that, Lord. You're sovereign God, and you guide our steps. You direct our steps and our paths, O Lord, and you oversee our lives, O God, and you give us all things that pertain to life and godliness, Lord, and for that we say thank you this morning. We bring our tithes, we bring our offerings, we bring them unto you, and we pray, Lord, that you would receive them as we give them with a heart of thanksgiving, knowing, Lord, that they'll come up a sweet-smelling sacrifice unto you. This is our worship this morning, Father, in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen and amen. Stand with me, please, this morning. Remember, BJ's offering in the box, House of Hope in the plates, and God bless you as you come. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. All right, are we ready for Kirsten and Miss Hillary? I'll get it, Kirsten. Go ahead, man. I got it. You don't have to do everything. I can help.
Oh, God.
Presence. Amen. Thank you, ladies. That was beautiful. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. That's what we got to have, is the presence of the Lord. That's what we must have, is the presence of the Lord. If God's presence does not show up when we meet, when we come together, if we don't experience God's presence, then our lives can't be changed. Our lives can't be impacted. Things can't be set in order. When we come to church, it's all about worshiping God and extending our love and our gratitude towards God in hopes, actually in faith, believing that as we do that, God will, as He said in His Word, He would come and dwell with us and be with us. And it's when you encounter the presence of God that your life is changed. You shouldn't leave church the same. When you come to church, when you come to God's house, you should never leave God's house like you came. You should always leave feeling better. You should always leave encouraged. You should always leave changed as a result of being in His presence. Our lives should always be a continual pursuit of the presence of the Lord. Jacob, when he first encountered God, it was at his house. He was at Bethel, the house of the Lord. And when he awoke, he said, "Surely the presence of the Lord was in this place." And he said, "I didn't even know it." What he meant was he didn't know it at first. He knew it after the fact. He didn't know it after the fact. That's why he said, "This is none other than Bethel, the house of God." So when we come to God's house, we should always come with the intent to experience God's presence. Be a presence-based, presence-minded church. Because if we don't have His presence, then we really don't have anything. It's just a meeting and a coming together. Hallelujah. So thank you, girls. That was beautiful. And it encourages us to go after His presence. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. The kiddos can be dismissed. Go with Miss Ashley this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. There they go. Praise God. Did you get YouTube working back there, Miss Kirsten? You got it? All righty. I'm going to begin this morning with a video clip, and then I will come and start from there. So if you would, please watch the video clip. Do I need to turn the lights off? Brother, get those lights for me. obviously we celebrate this weekend Memorial Day, which will be tomorrow, which will be a time that we remember all of those that have fallen in every battle we've ever fought, as you saw them all listed at the end of the presentation there, beginning from the Revolutionary War until current day. What we enjoy in our nation, this freedom that we have, freedom to come together like we have today, to a place of our own choice, to worship a God whom we choose to worship, how we choose to worship, how we see set forth in the Bible that we can worship, to have the freedom of that expression of worship is not anything that came cheaply. Freedom never comes cheap. The price of freedom is, always has been, and always will be blood. Not just any blood, but the blood of human beings. What we enjoy in America, people can say what they want about America, and even those that enjoy its privileges of citizenship, whether they were born here or whether they have obtained citizenship through the means afforded them by our government. You can say whatever you want, but there's no question about it. We still live in the greatest country on the planet. There's no question about that. And Memorial Day is a time, I mean, today, it's, if we're not careful, we tend to focus more on the barbecue, you know, and we tend to focus more on, you know, what time are we going to fire up the barbecue pit and, you know, get together and have good times. For some, it's the beginning of summer. It's not an official date or calendar date for beginning the summer, but for a lot of people, because it coincides with school getting out and all those kinds of things, it's looked upon in terms of that. But we do those men and women who have fallen in the line of duty, who have given the ultimate sacrifice, their life. They fought for something that they believed in. They fought for something they believed in, and that was freedom. Freedom to be free, to be free to express yourself however you want to express, not to be under the bondage and the tyranny of an oppressive government or dictatorship, but to be free, to be able to own your own land, to be able to own your own homes, to be able to go and work and earn a living, and to be, of course, to be able to worship, and all of the things that we talk about when we talk about freedom that we have in this nation are all things that were purchased by blood. Freedom is always, always, always purchased by blood of human beings, because the blood of animals, as we know, the Bible says the blood of bulls and goats could not take away sin. And I was praying about my message today and just seeking the Lord about a message today. I'm really not an event preacher. I never have been in the past. I guess in a pastoral role, you have to be a little more mindful of event days like Mother's Day, Father's Day, Memorial Day, 4th of July, those kinds of things. You have to kind of lean that direction. So you try your best to get the mind of the Lord and go somewhere to where you can encourage your congregation and talk to them about the event and somehow correlate or tie that together with a scriptural precept, so that when the congregation leaves, they've been encouraged about the event, whatever it is, because events are important to people, and they've also been edified and strengthened by the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and edifying the body and making them strong. And I was thinking about, what is it to memorialize? What do we mean when we say it's Memorial Day? It means we remember. We remember. It's good to sit around and watch the old movies of all of the, there'll be movies, war movies on this weekend, Alpha Gazoo. And used to we watched them, but not so much anymore. But it's good to remember, that's what it means. Remember we go, and it used to be called Decoration Day. When it really first started in the 1800s, it was to honor and to remember those that fought in the Civil War. We lost more men and women in the Civil War than all of our wars combined together because it was fighting amongst ourselves. And they would go to the cemeteries of the fallen soldiers and they would decorate them with flowers and flags. And it really didn't become a legal holiday or a calendared holiday. I believe it was 1971 is when it was first commemorated and recognized as a legal holiday that would impose all of the benefits that would come along with that, days off and parades and celebrations and memory of men and women who had fought and given their lives so that we could enjoy freedom that we have. So I encourage you this weekend, the remainder of this weekend and tomorrow, while you're firing up the barbecue pit, while you're cooking your hamburgers and your hot dogs or whatever it is that you'll cook, while you're going and doing whatever parades you may do or celebrating whatever commemorative things that you may do at this time of year, whatever plans of vacations or trips or whatever, I encourage you, remember those that paid the price for you to enjoy the things that you'll do this weekend. Remember those that gave their lives. As I was looking through videos to try to find something to play, I was so stirred and moved at everything that I saw in remembering that. It's no different with our spiritual life. We have such freedom. We're free from the bondage of sin. We're free from the enslavement of the devil and the devices of Satan. We're no longer bound, those of us that were, by drugs or alcohol or sins of our past that controlled our lives. We're no longer bound by those things, but we're what? We're free. We're free from that. Oh, I'm free from the fear of tomorrow, and I'm free from the guilt of the past, and I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. Oh, I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last. Woo, glory to God. I like that song. I think I'll sing it again. Oh, I'm free from the guilt of tomorrow, or the fear of tomorrow, and I'm free from the guilt of my past, and I've traded my shackles for a glorious song, and I'm free, praise the Lord, free at last. See, we are free today as Christians, as believers, as those who have been washed in the blood of Jesus, those who have experienced Calvary's crimson flow. We're free. We no longer have to live in bondage. We no longer have to live in fear. We no longer have to live in oppression. We no longer have to be ruled, manipulated, or controlled by the things of this world or by the devil. We are free. Hallelujah. Are you free this morning? Just as surely as we're free in America, praise God, we're free in the church, we're free in the world, we're free from the world, hallelujah. And the price that was paid for that freedom that we enjoy as Christians is no different. As it is in the natural, the price for freedom in whatever country, It doesn't matter what country you go to. It doesn't matter what place on the planet you are. The price for freedom is the same, is it not? I mean, go and look at the history. I'm not a big historian, but I watch a lot of war movies, or I did in times past. And any community, any nation, any people that sought after freedom all paid the same price. And that price was blood, no matter where they were. Whether it was the Scottish that were trying to be freed from the English, or whether it was the colonists who would come to try to be free from Britain, or whether it's the trying to liberate and bring freedom to other lands across oceans, whatever, wherever it is, the price was always the same, and it was blood. Freedom cannot be negotiated at tables with pens and contracts, because pens and contracts are null and void, and they can be broken so easily. And until something is really so precious to you that you're willing to die for it, there's really no conviction there. There's really no guarantee there, because the oppressor will continue to oppress until they realize that the people are willing to spill their blood for their freedom. Will not be able to control them anymore, because the power that's in blood, the life, the Bible said, is in the blood. And when people are willing to sacrifice their blood for something that they feel so strongly in, what can you do with that? Well, as it is in the natural, so it is in the spiritual. You see, we were all born in a fallen state. We were all living lives of no promise, of no hope of tomorrow, lives of oppression, lives of control, lives of addictions by the devices of Satan and the tools of the devil. I mean, all of us in some way, shape, form, or fashion were enslaved to something, and the only thing that has made us free from that was the blood of the Son of God. So when we think about Memorial Day today, I was thinking about Memorial Day. Remember, the day of remembrance. Take time on this day to remember all of the men and all of the women who had shed their blood so that we could enjoy freedom. We, as believers, ought to take time to remember the blood that was shed that purchased our freedom. Because just like we seem to, I don't know if I want to use the word take for granted, but I guess that's it. We seem to take it for granted. It doesn't seem to really be on the forefront of a lot of our minds, some more than others, but I dare say the majority, Memorial Day is more a day of just partying and going to the lake or taking a trip than it is of commemorating or remembering the dead who gave their lives so that we could be free and do those things. And how much also in the church do we seem to lose the grasp of what we enjoy, our freedom. I know what it is to be in bondage. I know what it is to be addicted. I was a drug addict for a very, very long time. I was an alcoholic for a very, very long time. My life was controlled by other things for a very, very long time. And you don't realize how bad it really is until you come out of it, or till you hit bottom and realize the need to come out of it. But how often do we seemingly take for granted, and do we forget the price paid for our freedom as believers? in 1 Corinthians, chapter number 11, verses 23 through 26, the Apostle Paul gives instruction to the church at Corinth concerning the Lord's Supper. And when the Lord's Supper was instituted by the Lord on what we know to be the last Passover meal, or the Lord's Supper, that he gathered his disciples together in that room there, and they all had partook of the Lord's Supper or the Passover meal with him, and he told them that this would be the last time they would sit and eat of that again. He gave some instruction, and Paul is passing this on to the church at Corinth because they were getting it out of order. He was trying to set in order an ordinance on how to commemorate and how to partake and receive of the Lord's Supper. But it's the content of what he said when he quoted the words of Christ that I really want to bring out to you this morning. He says in chapter 11, verse 23, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." This do in remembrance of me. "After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Jesus tells his disciples that are there at the Last Supper with him. But not only is he telling them, but it is an ordinance that is handed down and carried out, not just in the Gospels, but even in the epistles that would be the letters that would set in order, or that would govern, if you will, certain ordinances of the church. And this is one of those perpetual things that he said that are to always be done. He said, whenever, as often as you come together. He didn't say you had to do it every Sunday. He didn't say you have to do it on the first Sunday of every month. We do it on the first Sunday of every month. That's kind of a thing a lot of churches follow suit on. Some churches have it to where when you just walk in the door every Sunday, every service, when you walk in the door, there's a table set up and there's communion elements there. There's the bread and there's the juice. And when you walk in, you can or cannot. It's not a have-to thing that they impose on you. But if you desire to partake of it, then you can. Some churches do it just on special occasions, on Easter. Some do it weekly. I think the Roman Catholic Church, they do it on a weekly basis. It's called Mass, and they come and they do it. But however often as you do it, indicating that it is expected of us to do that. And the reason that we do that is for a memorial. Just like the reason we, really the core meaning of Memorial Day, as I told you, is not about a hamburger or a hot dog. It's not about baked beans and potato salad. It's not about the barbecue pit. It's not about the lake. It's not about a trip to the beach. Really, bless you. Really, the meaning of Memorial Day is to remember the blood that was shed for you to enjoy the freedoms that you have. They didn't just shed blood they didn't shed blood so that you could be captive. They didn't shed blood so that you could live under a dictatorship. They shed blood so that you and I could be free. Hallelujah to God. That's why they shed their blood. And that's why it's Memorial Day, to remember. And Jesus said, look, I'm going to pay a great price. I'm not going to eat this supper with you again until I see you in heaven. This is the last time we're going to eat of this supper, but I'm going to leave you an ordinance. I'm going to institute something now that as often as you will, as often as it'll cross your mind, you need to partake of these elements. You need to partake of the bread that symbolizes my body, which is broken for you. My body, which is broken so you can be free from sickness. My body, which is broken so you can be free from ailments and disease and infirmities. My body that is broken for you. He said, as often as you'll come together and meet, as often as you take this bread, I need you to do this in remembrance of me. I need you to remember that my body was broken and my blood was shed so that you could be free. You can do it once a week. You can do it once a month. You can do it every service. You can do it every day. But whenever you do it, don't forget to remember the reason that you do it is not some church ordinance, but the reason that you do it is to remember me, to memorialize me. Because when you do that, you do show. See, it's really a bold statement. It's a statement of remembrance as well as a declaration of the resurrection. He said, because as often as ye do this, as often as you take the bread, as often as you drink the cup, he said, you do show the Lord's death, what? Until he comes. So not only do we memorialize, not only do we remember. Remember, we don't enjoy what we enjoy as Christians. Golly, we don't enjoy what we enjoy as Christians just because. Well, I enjoy it because I believe. You get to enjoy it based on your belief. Because of what he did. See, some people put more stock in the fact because they believe in the fact that because he did. You see? Yes, we have to believe. Yes, 1,000 times yes, we have to believe. But don't make the mistake of thinking that your belief outweighs what he did. Because it doesn't. He said, as often as you come together, as often as you come together and you decide that you want to take the bread which symbolizes my body and the blood, the cup, this cup is the New Testament blood. How did he say it? He said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Hebrews talks about a better covenant with better promises. We're not under an old covenant anymore. We're not under the old law anymore. And thank God we're not. Was the law bad? No, the law wasn't bad. Had it not been for the law, we'd never known we sinners. Had it not been for the law, we'd have never knew that we needed a Savior. But thanks be unto God, he sent a Savior who was willing to shed and pay the ultimate price for our redemption, for us to be free, for us to enjoy freedom from the bondages of Satan, freedom from the fear, freedom from worry, freedom from stress. You know, we walk around stressed out and worried and don't have to because he's paid a price. That price was his blood, and sometimes it seems to be such a, you know, kind of like a hee-haw thing, like such a casual, you know, everyday, just mundane thing. It seems to have gotten to that point, and it's a travesty that we let it get to a place that we don't honor, that we don't remember, that we don't memorialize it. We don't really, really think about what we have and about how we obtained it, about the price that was paid for us to have it. He said, this is the New Testament where? In my blood. This is not a legal document that was drawn up and signed with the ink that flowed from a pen. No, this is a testament, all right. It's a document, all right. But it's sealed in blood. You see, it goes all the way back to the ancient Eastern culture of covenant. Blood covenant. See, man's word could be broken too easily. A contract that is merely sealed by the ink that flows from the end of the point of a pen can be broken before the ink ever dries on the paper. But there's something about a blood covenant. Westerners really don't understand it because you got to go way back into ancient history and more so Eastern history to really grasp the bond of blood covenant. They would cut their hands and they would mix blood or their arms, and they would interlock their arms and they would mix their blood. And that thing was a covenant that was not broken. It wasn't entered into lightly, and it wasn't broken lightly. The consequences would be severe. And Christ says, this is the New Testament in my blood, that the writer of Hebrews said is a better testament, a better covenant with better promises. He would write in Galatians, he asked this question in Galatians 5. He makes his statement. First of all, he makes his statement 5:1, stand fast. Therefore, in the liberty or freedom, he's telling the Galatians, stand fast in the freedom, liberty. That's freedom. Stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Stand in the freedom, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. And don't you be entangled again in bondage, in a yoke of bondage. See, it would do the church well. It would do the church of the Lord Jesus Christ well to really remember the price that was paid for our salvation. To really remember the price that was paid for the consummation and the birthing of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. This thing came about only through shed blood. This thing came about only through the blood of the Son of God. That's why the church exists today. That's why the church, not because men got together and formed bylaws and constitutions and organized, structured church government this and articles and tenets of faith here and these things over here. No, the church is here today because Jesus decided that he would shed his blood so that the church could exist. And upon that, we should realize that we don't need to be in bondage to anything. How insulting to Christ to say that what he did on the cross in the shedding of his blood and the giving of his life was not enough to suffice man, was not enough to suffice religion. You see, that's why I believe that Jesus instituted what we know to be communion or the Lord's Supper. I believe he wanted us to remember. I know he did because he said it, as often as you do this, remember me. Remember about my body and remember about my blood. Whenever you do it, for crying out loud, guys, remember the price that I paid so you could enjoy being delivered, so you could just enjoy being free, so you could just enjoy being saved, so you'd be able to enjoy eternal life, so you could enjoy all of the things that I want to provide for you that all come through what I'm going to do. I'm going to establish you to be a free people. For he whom the Son has made free is free indeed. It doesn't matter what anybody else says. Doesn't matter what any other church says. Doesn't matter what any other organization says. Doesn't matter what the media says. Doesn't matter what anybody says. God's word says that whoever the Son of God makes free, makes free. How did he make you free? By shedding his blood. How did the men and women that have fought, bled, and died make us free? When we're born as citizens of the United States of America, we are born free. Hallelujah to God. We are born free. We're not born in captivity. We're not born in enslavement. We're not born under oppression. We're not born under some dictatorship. But we are born free as citizens of the United States of America. You know why? Because people bled and died so that we could be. So that we could enjoy all of the legal rights that we possess as citizens of this great United States of America. I'm so tired of hearing people ditch on the United States of America. I'm so tired of hearing people that live in our country enjoy our privileges, our rights, and our freedoms ditch on the United States of America. Get yourself up. I'll buy you a one-way ticket to anywhere. Just get out of here and go somewhere else. And KYMS, keep your mouth shut. Because the price was far too great that was paid for people to stand around and enjoy privileges and then degrade and demean the very things that human blood has paid the price for. It's insulting to them. It's insulting to their memory. It's insulting to their honor. They want to burn flags and all of these kinds. It's no different. It's no different when Christians want to try to add to what Christ has already done. Want to try to make laws and say that what he did really just wasn't enough. It wasn't sufficient. Got to add this to it. That's what the whole book of Galatians is about. It's a law grace issue. Paul said, stand fast in the liberty, in the freedom wherewith Christ has made you free. And don't you get tangled up again in the yoke of bondage trying to fulfill the law. Because if you're going to live by the law, if you're going to live by any part of it, you got to live by all of it. That's what he said. If you're going to live by any of it, then you got to live by all of it. And there's not a soul on the planet, in the church or out of the church, that can fulfill that law and live by that law. No way, no how. That was its intent, was to show mankind how miserably hopeless he was to fulfill the righteous demands of God. Couldn't happen, won't happen, never happen. But he says, because I love you enough, I don't want you to be in bondage, not even to my law. Get that? He didn't even want us to be in bondage to his law, but he wanted us to be free citizens of his kingdom. Free to love him. He really gave us a choice to be free to choose to serve him or free not to. You can be free to enjoy the benefits of his covenant, of his kingdom, or you can be free to reject them and suffer the consequences. So, I think about what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 when he quoted the words of Christ. Whenever you come together, as often as you'll come together and you'll take this bread, he said, remember, this bread is my body, which is broken for you. And also the cup, which is the New Testament, in my blood. He said, this do in remembrance of me. Here's my point. If we, and if the church as a whole, would remember, would really remember where it wasn't, it wasn't a casual little thing. See, sometimes we make it too casual, don't we? But when you see the, when you saw that video, was that casual? Or did it make you really think of the reality of what Memorial Day is? Because the whole video was about people that died. It wasn't graphic, but it didn't need to be graphic. You understood when you saw the flags draped the coffins. You understood when you saw the back of a C-130 aircraft with the belly opened up. Two soldiers standing there, arm in arm, as they look as their comrades in arms, bodies have been flown from overseas to be taken out of the back of that plane and taken to a final place of rest. You understand as you look across the acres and acres and acres. I was reading, I want to say there's a lot of national cemeteries, and I want to say that this particular one was Arlington, that there's 220,000 crosses at Arlington. And there are national cemeteries that date back all the way to the Civil War. There were so many that died that they had to have national cemeteries to bury them. And that's how Memorial Day would start. They would take the last Monday in May, or no, it was May 30th they would go, and they would decorate and put out flags and remember what they did. See, it was the reality of that when you saw the video. That wasn't just a passing thing, but the reality hit home. I think that we need more reality and not a casual thought when we take communion. I think sometimes it becomes too casual because we have a cup and we have a piece of bread and we have a preacher that reads 1 Corinthians, or he'll quote out of the Gospels when Jesus was actually having the Last Supper, to one of the two places they'll go, and they'll quote that scripture, and it just becomes so casual. And we see a piece of bread, the little wafer, and we see the little cup, and the song that plays about the blood, and it's just casual. But that's not what he had in mind. He said, as often as you come together and you do this, I need you to remember. I need you to remember. So today, we're going to remember, and we're going to do it a little different. Now, the scenes that are about to show on this particular video are graphic. And so, if you're disturbed by blood, or the children would be disturbed by blood, you may want to take them in the other room, whereas not to bother them or yourself. As the servers will prepare to serve, if you'll just hold, all of you will just hold the elements until everyone has been served, we will partake together. But today, a little different, I want you to remember. Okay. Turn them all off, Brother Michael. see. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the reality of our freedom. That is the cold, hard truth of what it took and the price that was paid for you to be a Christian, for you to enjoy eternal life, for you to be free from bondages, hang-ups, for you to be healed, for you to have peace. Just as surely as it took shed blood to secure our freedoms as a people of the United States of America, it took the shed blood of the Son of God to secure our freedoms as citizens of the kingdom of heaven that are part of this great body called the church. And it's important to remember. It's important to remember this weekend the price that was paid as a nation. And it's important to remember every day that we live the price that was paid for our salvation. And that is why I believe we have the instruction found in 1 Corinthians. And so it doesn't become convenient and it doesn't become casual by any stretch of the imagination when we read the words of the Apostle Paul as he writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." So as you take that little wafer that you hold in your hand, don't let it be casual. But remember what he did, so you could enjoy what you have in terms of a Christian. Let's take the bread. Hallelujah. After the same manner also, or just like he had done with the bread, now he moves to the cup. And he said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood." I don't try to gross nobody out. Sometimes we need the reality. Sometimes we need the reality. And as horrific and as bloody as that was, what Christ endured was worse. We can do a lot with makeup and special effects, and I think that they did a wonderful job in portraying the sufferings of Christ like it's never been portrayed before visually. But that really scratch the surface. Oh, how the blood splattered. And the promises that we enjoy, those promises in the New Covenant, in the New Testament, that we enjoy, those privileges that we enjoy as believers, whatever they may be, every one of them was bought with the price of His blood. Just like every promise and every privilege that we enjoy that's in that Constitution of the United States of America was bought and paid for with blood of men and women who believed in freedom. Likewise, every promise in that covenant, in that New Testament that we enjoy as citizens of the kingdom of heaven, was bought and paid for by somebody who believed in freedom. By their blood. And that was the blood of the Son of God. And today we've got splits and we've got divisions and we've got denominations and we've got separations and we can't get along with this group and can't get along with that group. And Jesus is just saying, look, I need you to remember my blood. Remember that it was shed for these freedoms. He says in verse 25, after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup. See, we hold this little cup of juice, and if we're not careful, it becomes way too casual. He says, this cup, what this cup represents, and what the cup they were drinking that day represented was the New Testament in His blood. In His blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. Let's take the cup.
For all that you've done, I will thank you.
Hallelujah.
For all that you're going to do.
Oh, yes, Jesus.
For all that you've promised and all that you are is all that has carried me through. Jesus, I thank you.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
And I thank you, thank you, Lord. How I thank you.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving and setting me free. Thank you for giving your life just for me. How I thank you. Gratefully thank you.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
We thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you, Lord.
Sing that thank you for the bridge or whatever that is there.
Thank you for loving and setting me free.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you for
Oh, I thank you, Lord Jesus, so much. I thank you.
Jesus, we thank
I thank you, Lord, so much.
Gratefully thank you. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Father, truly, from the very, very, very depths of our hearts and our souls this morning, Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. We remember the price that you paid. We remember your broken body. And we remember your shed blood. The awfulness of it and the horridness. We remember, Lord, and God, help us never, ever, ever, ever let it become casual to us or in any way take for granted what you did for us to purchase our freedom. Lord, may we always remember. May we always remember in Jesus' wonderful and magnificent and holy name we pray. Everyone said amen and amen. Praise the Lord. It's a little bit different service, I know, so just be dismissed. God bless you. Have a great weekend. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. We'll see you here Wednesday night.